If you would, turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 2. This has been our key verse for this series. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. It says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through the fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." If you look at 14 again, notice it said that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. Well, we know that the devil's still on this planet, because 2 Corinthians 4:4 tells us he's the ruler of this evil system down here. So he didn't disappear. He wasn't eliminated. He's not gone. So we got to find out what that word destroyed means. And in the Greek, it means to render inoperative, to be made of none effect. Jesus stripped the devil of the power and authority that he took from Adam and Eve, right after God gave Adam and Eve the power and authority. But Jesus showed up, and he got all power and all authority back. And Jesus saying, through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. Notice the word might right there. If he's already did it, why did he say might? The reason why is the devil's only rendered inoperative. The devil's only destroyed in the lives of those that live by faith. Amen. Jesus rendered the devil inoperative in your life because you live by faith. But Brother Chris, I've been in fear. How can I stop living by fear and live by faith? Choose to.
Amen.
That's it. Choose to. Fear's going to hit you. You can't help but get hit by fear this week. Fear is the spirit of the devil. He hasn't left. He's going to attack. But when you decide to walk by faith at that moment, the devil's defeated again. Amen. Now that's real easy to say. But when it happens, there you go now. Because the fears are very real. You feel a pain in your body. What happens as soon as you feel that pain? Fear. It just happens. Well, are you going to decide, I'm going to be a faith man or woman? I'm going to walk by faith. I'm going to talk by faith. I'm going to think by faith. I'm going to act in faith. You have to make that decision, or you will be moved by fear to deal with that problem. You don't want to deal with a problem based in fear.
Amen.
Deal with the problem based in faith. And that's hot off the Holy Ghost press right there. That's really good. Slow down. Psalms 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I'm God." Slow down and get with God. Be still don't mean just, you know, you're like this. That's not what that's talking about one bit. It's be still up here focusing on Him. Yep. Be still. Because see, the fear's coming your way. And the devil's defeated in your life because you're born again. You're a son and daughter of God. But if you let that fear take root. In other words, the devil's going to say fear, and when you entertain the fear, you let him in. You've got to slow down. I believe it's in Isaiah. I'd have to look it up. I think it's Isaiah 28:16. It says, last part of the verse, says, "He that believes shall not make haste." He that believes shall not make haste. You ever been in a hurry? Or is this just me? Did you get in a hurry and kind of mess things up? Or was that just me too? You know why you're in a hurry? Fear. Well, I'm running late for work. Well, is that fear? Well, you know, but that's just part of life. Well, no. That's part of death. You really want to live? Part of life is not fear. Part of life is walking by faith. See how practical this gets? You can be in a hurry and not watching what you're doing and get in trouble on the road. Slow it down. But my boss said if I... Amen. But my boss said if I'm late again. Okay, well, then start believing God for a new job. I know that's humorous. But is there a point that we're supposed to get in fear? Boy, this is getting good already. Is there a point? Slow down. Slow down. If you got to apologize, apologize. If you're not used to saying you're sorry, get used to it. I'm sorry. I messed up. I have found in my life when someone apologizes from the heart, it's fixed. Don't give me your dumb excuses now. I just screwed up. I am so sorry. You'd receive that, wouldn't you? Well, yeah. But see, the devil won't let you do that. You got to get in a hurry. He wants to mess up your life. I want you to know that the devil just is not out just for you. He hates 7 billion people. And since you're born again right now, he don't want you on this planet. And if he can help you get to heaven quick, he'll do it. If he can kill you with the flu, he'll try. So slow it on down. Flu hits you, I come against that in the name of Jesus. I'm not taking that mess. I'm a child of the King. Jesus died 2,000 years ago and took flu on that cross. He redeemed me from the curse and flu's in the curse. And since he took the curse, I don't have to take the curse. And I command the flu to leave my body now in Jesus' name. I appropriate what you gave me 2,000 years ago, God. And I thank you for your quickening power running off all this attack and causing this body to feel completely healed, healthy, whole, well, and sound in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That's what you got to do when you all by yourself. All I did is just close my eyes and do what I normally do. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
What if it stays? Keep thanking the Lord for the healing. Verse 15 again, it said, and deliver them who through the fear of death were all their lifetimes subject to bondage. That just described mankind as we see it. All their lifetime, they are being subjected to bondage. How? Through the fear of death. That's not just a fear of physically dying, but that's the fear of losing anything. Losing anything you have, anything you want, anything you need. Losing your health, losing your prosperity, losing friends or family. It's fear. Fear of losing your job. Like I mentioned earlier, it's fear. We want to step out of the fear mode, and we do that by choosing to get into the faith mode. When do we do that? Pretty much all day. And when you go to bed at night. This is called fighting the good fight of faith. 1 Timothy 6:12. This is called earnestly contending for the faith. Jude 3. This is called being at war. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2 real quick. You got to hear this, and I'm not going to mess it up.
Okay.
Verse 3 and 4, please, sir. You got there quick.
You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier.
Thank you, sir. We're in warfare down here. Well, I didn't know that. Well, you wake up to it. And if you wake up to it and you start fighting in faith, you're going to start seeing those victories that you've heard other people talk about. Good place to say amen. You're going to start seeing the prosperity flow, and you're going to start feeling the peace and walking in a higher level of health. But you have to fight. the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. That means unending life. That means God's right way of life down here. 1 Timothy 6:12. And you do that with the confession of your mouth. You do it like I just did a minute ago. You declare your faith. Amen?
Amen.
Don't be asking God for something He's already given you. Okay? If you know He gave it to you, declare it and take it. 95% of Christians praying is praying for stuff they already got.
That's right.
And that's why they don't get it.
Rewind.
Huh?
It's like you just keep hitting rewind.
Yes. And they wonder why it's not happening. Because you already got it. So why don't you just go ahead and take it?
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
You know, it's like going to a bank. You got $1,000 in the bank account and you want to go get $100 out. Well, I don't think I'm going to go down there because I don't think they're going to give me the money. I ain't going to waste my time. Why wouldn't they give you your money? I know it sounds stupid, but this is the point of this. You're not going down there because you don't believe they're going to give you your money. Whoa, whose money is it?
My money.
Well, why wouldn't you go down there? You wouldn't slow down. I wouldn't either. I'm going to go get my money. I will get my money. Well, Jesus hung on a cross and shed His blood to give me divine health.
Right.
I'm taking my health.
Amen.
Well, if you get sick, I come against the attack. I'm telling you, things change in your head when you see the sickness as an attack.
Right.
Boy, is that big.
See
it as an attack. Say, no, I'm not going to wave the white flag and say, just beat me up for the next week or two. That's an attack. See, we've been so programmed to find out about something going on in our body that we right away go find out all the information on it. You're messing up your faith real quick. Take care of that attack. Get the victory. Well, you know, aren't we supposed to know what it is? Can I tell you what it is?
The curse.
She knows too. Do we have to describe it another way? It's the curse. Well, I want to pray knowledgeable. Oh, so you go to the medical book and not to God's Word to pray knowledgeable? You're really missing it. It's a curse.
Amen.
Jesus took the curse.
Amen.
He became a curse, so you don't have to take the curse. What if it's my own fault that I messed up? Repent for making a bad decision, but don't let the affliction stay in your body. See, that's back to pride. Well, you know, I did it. I deserve it. No, you know, you need to repent of pride because you're about to dig a deep hole real quick. You want the pain, you want the sickness, the disease, whatever affliction, whatever attack hits your body, you want it out of your body at that moment because Jesus took it and you're going to honor Him and honor His blood and not let it be in the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Get your pride out of the way.
Amen.
That pride goes right before a fall.
Amen.
God resists the proud. And everything I've said already, you're doing that in fear. It's all fear-based. You got to get out of fear. I'm going to walk in faith. I don't care if I messed up. I repent and keep on going. What if I've been doing something wrong for a long time? Well, then, you know, repent is still just as short of a time, no matter how long you've been doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen?
Well, I just feel so guilty. Well, why don't you be a Christian? Because Christians don't take guilt.
Amen.
Well, I feel so condemned. Well, why don't you be a Christian? Because Christians don't take condemnation.
Right.
You know why you take guilt and condemnation? Fear-based. See how fear's all through our life?
Yeah.
Let's stop that. Well, I've messed up so much. I've hurt so many friends and family. Okay. So where are we going with that? Where are we going with that? Except from here out, hurt them again and again and again. Where are we going? Let's stop right now. Let's repent. Let's be the man or woman of God God created us to be. Let's step out in faith and do it. What if they don't forgive me? They'll come around. Amen? Go to Romans chapter 1. Romans 1:16, it says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith." I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Gospel means the good news of Christ. Christ means the anointed one and his anointing. It's the good news of the anointed one and his anointing. What does that produce? It's the power of God, not only for heaven later, but heaven now. Not only healing later, but healing now. Not only prosperity later, but prosperity now. Because salvation means heaven later and heaven now. It's the power of God to everyone that believes. Did you hear the select group? Well, how come I'm not experiencing the power of God, the anointed one, his anointing moving in my life? Apparently you don't believe. Well, it can't be cut and dry like that. Yes, it can. Does it look like this is my opinion? I'm just reading this stuff. Amen? Amen. See, we got to wake up. Amen. I'm going to believe. And the gospel, the good news of Christ, what he did, the blessings he brought to me through his blood, I'm taking them all. This year, you're going to see so many more signs, wonders, and miracles in this church. You're going to see some signs that are just going to flat out make you wonder. Like, you got to be kidding. No, God's not kidding. Not kidding one bit. It's time to see those signs and wonders and miracles that you can't explain away.
Amen.
You know what? I'm just like you. If I get healed of a headache, I feel a whole lot better. But you can explain that away. But when a hand is missing and it shows up, now talk to me. Talk to me. That's getting really big in me. God's going to give me a man or a woman without a right hand. And he's going to tell me to tell them. God's saying, go ahead and shake my right hand. And when you shake my right hand, you'll have a right hand to shake my right hand with.
That's right. Come on.
Amen. Well, I don't believe that. Well, then you won't be bothered with it. I believe it.
Amen.
Leave us alone. We're going to get bothered.
Amen.
Glory be to God. That, you know, that's going to just going to mess me up. Because I'm going to reach to an arm with no hand, and when I get over there, I'm going to feel a hand in my hand. If that ain't going to mess me up, I don't know what would.
Amen.
I'll mess that person up too. Why can't we see that? God created us. He can sure put another hand on the arm, can't he?
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a chapter and verse of this, but I really believe we got a spare parts room in heaven. He's just going to pull out another hand and send it right on down. Boy, you got a really vivid imagination. Yeah, and you watch it manifest.
They don't need them up there.
They don't. Yeah, that's right. They don't need them. We need another hand down here. Right hand, sir, down here. We appreciate that. I believe that stuff. I remember years ago when I prayed for a 9-year-old little girl. Her leg was an inch and a half shorter than the other one. I knelt down, put my hand on her shin, and commanded that leg to grow out to be equal with the other leg. And not only felt it when I had my hand right there, but I saw it move. Well, I don't believe that. You know, a man with an argument is no match to a man with an experience. I'm still telling you about that. That happened my first church job when I think I was 20 or 21. And I looked at that, and I looked at her, and she's standing like this, and the service finally ended, and all I could do is go to the prayer room and get on my knees because I was just absolutely messed up. And I was thinking, this stuff really works. Wow. Well, you know, Brother Chris, you know a lot about the Word. I said I was 21, not my age now. I didn't know that much back then. I just had faith. Just wanted to walk in faith. The little girl wanted to walk in faith. Her mama wanted to walk in faith. And they walked out in faith. Legs the same. I went into UK's children intensive care because I was invited in there to pray for a one-year-old that had a pneumonia, and in the fluid of that pneumonia, there was staph infection. Well, that'd kill anybody. I talked to the mom and dad for 15 minutes, taught them a little bit of faith. We went in there, we prayed for the baby, came back out, talked to him another 10 minutes. I said, call me when the doctor tells you the good news. He called me the next day and said, Pastor Chris. I said, yeah. He said, we got some good news. I said, what's going on? He said, the doctor came in this morning because, see, the day before, they told the parents that their daughter was not going to make it through that day. And he called me the next day. They said, my daughter's going to live. Said, it's going to be about 3 months in here, but she's going to live. Well, that was a miracle. Well, I got off the phone, and I started speaking the word again, and in 3 weeks, she was out. I didn't say 3 months. 3 weeks. We saw her twice. Cute as a button. Pneumonia and staph infection. You see why she was going to die? She celebrated her first birthday in intensive care. Why don't we see more of that? Well, why don't we do that? Why don't we do that? Oh, what if I pray for somebody, Brother Chris, and it doesn't happen? Well, what if it does? What a concept in thinking that way. Let's just roll with it, amen? See, you know why it doesn't happen? You're in fear. I don't want to hurt God's reputation. He's a big boy. He can take care of his reputation. Why don't you be the clay and let him be the potter? Amen? Amen. He can handle his reputation. Glory be to God. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed. Righteousness is God's right way of life. Wherein is God's righteousness revealed and experienced? In the good news of the Anointed One, that He is the power of God to everything you need, right here in the right here and now. Amen. I want to walk in that right way of life. Well, look what it said. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed or experienced from faith to faith. You notice it said faith to faith. It didn't say faith to fear. It didn't say fear to fear. Well, you know, how can I go from faith to fear? You made a choice. You made a choice. Oh, Brother Chris, something bad happened to me and just fear took me over. You let it. This is not the milk of the Word. This is the meat of the Word. Amen. You let it. When it takes you over, find your Bible. And get some faith-filled words in you because fear-filled words are taking over. Did you hear me? Where's my Bible? Wrong answer. Know where your Bible is. A lot of it should be in your heart. Amen? And this... technology age. Man, I got 50 Bibles in my phone. Get the word out. But you don't know what happened. I do. It's an attack. No, but this happened. I know that happened. It's an attack. The devil is trying to get you to look at what happened to increase your fear. Bring it back down to the devil's attacking. And Jesus defeated him 2,000 years ago. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested. He might destroy the works of the devil. 1 John 3:8. And John 19:30, Jesus hung on the cross and said, "It is finished." The devil that's attacking you has been destroyed. So why don't you enforce his defeat? You can only do that in faith.
Amen.
Where am I going to get that faith? Out of the Bible. They are faith-filled words. Romans 10:8 calls the Word of God the Word of faith. You need some faith at that time. But I'm telling you right now, make that transition to whatever's attacking you, what you call it, get back over to it's an attack and I'm not losing. I got God's word on it. Getting fired up. I'm ready for... This series might last a lot longer than I thought it did. Says, God's right way of life will be revealed from faith to faith. Then it said, the just shall live by faith. We're the just. When we choose to live by faith, we got a promise from the Lord in Romans 4:16. It's a faith that it might be by grace.
Amen.
It's a faith that it might be by God's operational power. Well, how come I'm not seeing power? Because you're not in faith. You have to get in faith. You can't get in and get out and get in and get out. If you do that, that's called double-mindedness. And in James 1:7-8, God said, don't let that man think that he should receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You stay in faith, whether you feel like it or not. You could be shaken. Can't stop my foot. Feeling fear on me. And you declare, I'm walking by faith,
amen.
Talking by faith, thinking by faith, fighting by faith, and I call this situation go now in Jesus' name. I got what I say, and I command the mountain of problems into the sea right now in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Don't care how I feel. Well, I'm already in fear because I feel it. No, no, it's an attack too.
Amen.
Stay in faith. Let's go a little deeper in that. You say, well, I'm in faith, but I'm not experiencing the power. Could it be that you possibly might miss it somewhere? Could it be that when you believe God for healing and healing wasn't immediate, you let faith get in? Excuse me, you let fear get in. Could it be?
Yeah.
I don't know about you guys, I raised both hands on that one.
Uh-huh.
We're talking real tonight.
Yeah.
That's why this church is called Reality Church. We keep it real.
Amen.
Could it be you were watching the TV the other day and it got you out of faith? It's a master at that.
Mm.
Well, I was just watching the news. Well, that confirmed it. If you want to get in fear, just turn the news on.
That's right.
It ain't going to take you over a few minutes. Well, I got to stay up with things. Oh, now you're making excuses to get in fear. We got to turn some things around, amen? I guarantee you, if you choose to walk by faith, no matter what comes your way, God will give you the victory every single time. He guaranteed it. Thanks be unto God who gives you the victory through Jesus Christ. Well, when you're in Jesus Christ, you're in faith. And that verse in 1 Corinthians 15:57, he just said, you're going to get the victory. He said in 2 Corinthians 2:14, thanks be unto God who always causes you to triumph in Christ. So when you get in Christ, it means you're getting in faith, or you can't be in Christ. So when you're in faith, he guarantees the triumph. Amen. It's a guarantee. Oh, well, how come it didn't work for me? Because you're between the amen and the there it is, and you let fear stop you from getting to your there it is. Stay in faith. But you don't know how I feel. I've been in this all my life. I know how fear feels. Just studying this series for the last 2.5 months, I felt a higher level of fear in this series. The devil don't want me to preach this kind of stuff. I got 5 audiences. The last thing he wants is all these people to hear that. Especially the 4 in jail. Devil's beating them up with guilt and condemnation, telling them life's over, and I come waltzing in and give them good news and pump them up and get them fired up, and they're ready just to take the devil out. Amen. He don't like that. I don't care. I like rubbing it in his face. I'm really hateful in the spirit. I hate that defeated enemy. I like seeing somebody change in there, that all their life the devil's had them, and now the devil don't have them no more.
Amen.
He's on our side now, devil. And he knows a lot more of your tricks than I do. You better watch out. Boy, does he have some strong testimonies on what God did to get you out of his life. I was in the max unit on Thursday, and I said, oh, guys, all you're doing is working on one major testimony in here. Glory be to God. Some of them look at me like, what turnip truck did he fall off of? Some people aren't used to being encouraged.
No.
They've lived in depression and discouragement, which is fear-based, all their life. Well, you know what? We're going to be about God's business, glory be to God. We're not going to be double-minded. We're going to be single-minded. And to do this, you've got to recognize when fear attacks. And I brought up a bunch of it already, but let me break it down a little bit more. What is fear? It's everything from mild dread to full-blown terror and panic. You say, well, I dread going to work tomorrow. Why are you getting in fear over that? We've all said it. Yeah, just look straight ahead and say, preach that, Pastor Chris. Somebody needed to hear that. Nobody know I'm talking to you. Praise the Lord. Why are you saying, come on in, devil. Sit by me and let's buddy up. That's what you just said. Because 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God hasn't given you the spirit of fear. Who gave it to you? The devil, who is the spirit of fear. And when you say, oh, I just dread going to work tomorrow, you're buddying up with the devil. Well, I don't think it's that serious. When you do, then the blessings will start flowing as you'll see the devil running out of your house. If you make allowances for the devil, he'll live with you the rest of your days. It said through the fear of death, they were all their lifetime subject to bondage. All their lifetime. Fear is doubt and unbelief. Fear is worry and stress. I just really stressed. Stop that. Well, I got a stressful job. Thank you. How long you been saying that? Well, I've been here 10 years. Probably just all messed up then because you've allowed fear in. Stress can't get you unless you let it in. I'm around stress every day. I just don't let none of it in. How do you stop that? I cast all my cares on God. I thank Him for sustaining me. That was 1 Peter 5:7 and Psalms 55:12, I believe it was. True, honest, just, pure, lovely, good report. Think on these things. Absolutely. But I can't help it. Whoa, 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 whoa. Is there ever take a picture of you? I've never seen a human robot. Did y'all get that? You can't help it. The problem with Christians today is we got too many wimpy Christians.
That's right.
They get saved and they want to be wimps. No. We got to fight. You know why God wants you blessed and prosperous? You know why He wants you to dress nice and drive nice and live nice and have a big house and you got cash in your pocket?
Because
amen. Because the goodness of God leads people to repentance. They see you carrying yourself like you're a multimillionaire, and they think, well, how come why you act so different? Well, because my daddy is Heavenly Father, and He takes care of His favorite son. And if you want to be a favorite son, call yourself that. Amen. He wants us to show the world how He treats His kids. And not just be like all the other religions in the world. Because we're not a religion. We have a relationship.
Amen.
So we need to step this thing up. Don't let fear in. Amen?
Amen.
Fear is the fear of failure, disappointment, being sick, not having enough. Fear is fearing what others are saying. And one of the worst ones is fearing what they're thinking about you. Stop that. Well, Lois, did you see how Donnie looked at me a minute ago? You know we've all done this. That's fear. What is he thinking? You don't have no idea. Get away from that kind of mess. The devil got you. Amen? He might be looking at you weird because he ate some bad pizza for lunch. We don't know. That's fear. Fear is dreading things not working out. You're dreading it. I dread going to the store. I dread going to work. I dread getting out on the highway. I dread getting in traffic. Oh, did you hear bad weather coming? Oh, you're just living in it. I'm not making light of it a bit. Do you see why we're not walking in the faith level we're supposed to walk in? Romans 12:3 says we have the measure of faith. Hebrews 12:2 says Jesus authors and finishes our faith. Mark 11:22 says have the faith of God. And Galatians 2:20 says the life which I now live in the flesh I live by the faith of the Son of God. We got the same faith that Jesus Christ has. Why don't we walk in it?
Amen.
Because fear tolerated is faith contaminated. Fear tolerated is faith contaminated. You can't be in fear and think you're in faith. That's called deception. You got to get out of fear, and we can live our life free from fear. You can live free from all fears. Well, I don't believe that. Well, apparently you hadn't read Psalms 34:4 then. David said, I sought the Lord and He heard me and delivered me from all my fears. So we can live in a hell-bound, evil world full of the spirit of fear and walk by faith? Yes. Let's do it this year. Let's have some major testimonies at the end of the year. And someone say, I'll remember what happened to you last May. Tell us again. Glory be to God. Powerful stuff, guys. This is powerful stuff. We need to start fighting.
Amen. That's right.
Stop making excuses.
That's right.
Start resisting fear. You'll resist fear more when you realize when you feel it, that is the devil. Fear is the devil personified. It is the devil. And you're not going to put up with the devil. It says neither give place to the devil in Ephesians 4:27. Well, if he tells me don't give him place, that's up to me, isn't it? Do you see how no power the devil has? Big bad devil coming in, gonna take you out. No, he ain't. He can't. Unless he can get in your head and get you to believe that he's bigger than your God. So what if I stay in faith? The devil can't get me. What if I get hit with sickness? Once again, I'm repeating myself and I'm playing it. It's an attack. Well, he got me. No. He got you when you receive it. You mean this sickness ain't real? Oh, no, it is very real. That's why you're hurting right now. It's an attack. Come against it in the name of Jesus. The devil will try to get place in your life with the words of fear. Don't give them place. You hear the words of fear, you go ahead and combat that with the words of faith. Romans 10:6 says, the righteousness of faith speaks. You're the righteousness of faith. You speak. Speak what? Verse 8 says, the word of faith. You declare the words of faith. Here's an example of it. The devil says you're sick. Right then, that's words of fear, isn't it? That would be fear, wouldn't it? As soon as you hear sickness, fear's going to grip you, isn't it? You right away say, I am healed according to 1 Peter 2:24, and then you declare it. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin. Dead to sin. Romans 6:7 says, he that is dead is freed from sin. Are you born again? You're dead to sin. Glory be to God. Ain't that good? Being dead to sin, we should live unto righteousness. We should live unto God's right way of life, by whose stripes you were healed. And then I would say, since Jesus bore my sins, listen to this wording now. Since Jesus bore my sins, I don't have to bear the effects of sin in my body because he took the sin. Amen. Sickness is an effect of sin. I don't have to have it. Lack is an effect of sin. Turmoil and stress is an effect of sin. It's all fear-based. I don't have to have it. But until you get spitting mad and dogged and stand your ground and stand up for what Jesus shed his blood to give you, you're going to have the bad stuff. You got to get violent. From the days of John the Baptist and now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. And the violent take it by force. Well, how come I'm not getting the kingdom? You ain't violent enough. Spiritually speaking, you got to get violent. Take it. If Jesus took the sin, why do I have to bear the effects of them? I don't, do I? So I choose to live God's right way of life right now, and I call my body healed, healthy, whole, well, strong and sound in Jesus' name. And God said, if I will decree things, he will establish them unto me and the light will show up. Job 22:28, I believe it is. Decree it. God said, if I declare my body healed, he will confirm what I say and create the fruit of my lips. Isaiah 57:19. So, Lord, your word says, I'm still praying. Lord, your word says, by whose stripes you were healed. Well, if I were healed, then I am healed.
Amen.
I take what he did 2,000 years ago. I take it. That means I appropriate it. And I call my body healed now. I take my healing by faith, thanking you, Lord, for healing me in Jesus' name. You just won the attack. I don't care if it disappeared like that or it didn't. You won. You wake up the next morning and you're still feeling some effects of that attack. You say, thank you, Lord, for healing my body 2,000 years ago. And I've received my healing by faith. Let me help you with something, because someone brought it up on Thursday in my Bible study, and I could see the deception of the devil in it, because we were talking about healing. And he looked at me and he said, well, you know what? It might not be God's timing. Do you see the deception in it? Mm-hmm. Maybe the healing's, he planned to come, you know, in a week or so. No. You missed timing completely because he gave it to you 2,000 years ago. You better watch saying it might not be God's timing. You want to know God's best? Amen? Do you want to know his best for you? He wants you instantaneously healed. Every single time. Every single time. I'm going after the instantaneous more and more and more. That's God's best. In closing, in 2 Corinthians 4:13, it says we have the same spirit of faith. We believe, therefore we speak. That's how you release your faith. As you believe and speak God's word, you're giving place to the spirit of faith, resisting the spirit of fear. And when you do this, you'll be delivered from all fears as you live in God's right way of life.